Hello, everyone. I am Ben Johnson, and this is the Perpetual Chess Podcast. Perpetual Chess is a weekly interview show where top chess players, authors, content creators, and accomplished amateurs discuss their careers and share stories and chess improvement tips. Perpetual Chess is a part of the Blue Wire Podcast Network, and we'd like to give special thanks to our presenting chess education sponsor, Chessable.com. For more information about the show, you can go to perpetualchesspod.com. But without further ado, let's get to the show. Hello, everyone, and welcome to a bonus edition covering the candidates here after round six of Perpetual Chess. It has been an exciting tournament so far. Before we introduce our guest, I just wanted to go over the very basic facts. As a lot of you may have already heard, after six rounds, Jan Nepomniachtchi is in the lead with 4.5 out of 6 off to a blazing start. Behind him, not by much, is GM Fabiano Caruana with 4 out of 6. And then fighting an uphill battle are the rest of the participants. Nakamura has 3 out of 6. Rapport has 3 out of 6. Rajabov has 2.5. Ding Liren has 2.5. Jan-Christoph Duda has 2.5. And just as everyone predicted in last place, Alireza Firouzja with 2 points. So a lot of drama, fascinating chess already. A couple other things to go over before we introduce our guest. The winning scores in recent candidates, courtesy of Tarjei Svensson, chess Twitter stalwart, were 8.5, 9, 8.5, 8.5, and 8.5 in the last 5 14-round candidates. So that means that Nepo only needs to draw, if he drew his remaining 8 games, already he'd be on 8.5, which was good enough to win 4 out of 5 of the candidates. If he were to win another one, he'd be in an even stronger position. So really a commanding position, although obviously Caruana, 0.5 back, still has good chances as well. Speaking of the chances, I did get an update from friend of the podcast, Ty Bruce Zimmerman of the Chess by the Numbers blog. The updated probabilities based on his model, and obviously take these with a grain of salt, but they do give you they give you the ability to estimate the statistical probability of certain performances based on the ratings. So Nepo would be 53.9% to win the candidates, Fabi 35.3%, and then a steep drop for everyone else. Rapport 4%, Naka 2.9%, Ding 2.5%, Duda 0.5%, Firouzja 0.4%, and Rajabov 0.4%. So 8 rounds to go still, lots could happen, but we have 2 firm leaders. So with all of that info out of the way, let's introduce our guest, someone I've been a fan of for a long time, as anyone who heard my book recap of Improve Your Chess Now. It's a book I often recommend and love. He is a grandmaster, 3-time champion of Norway, a journalist, and in addition to Improve Your Chess Now, also co-author of 5 Crowns, covering world championship history with none other than Yasser Seirawan. So let's welcome Grandmaster Jonathan Tisdall to the show. Welcome, Jonathan.
Hello, thanks. It's good to finally be here.
Yes, yes, long overdue. I think I even asked you to come on the podcast before, as the podcast was launching, because I've long been a fan of yours. I don't even think, people barely knew what podcasts were back 6 years ago, but we're finally making it happen.
It's that long. I do remember not being able to make it for the first time, and then watching the podcast grow a lot, and then so it's good. It's good to finally be here.
Yeah, and I'm always a fan of your writing, and especially when big events like this, the World Championship, and of course the candidates. This is when the chess history books are being written. So, Jonathan, I mean, what has surprised you? What has struck you? I mean, a lot has surprised me, but let's kick it over to you. What are your impressions of this tournament so far?
Well, I've gone on record as saying I had absolutely no predictions to make before the event. I could see almost anything happening. And I was very pleased to see that Vichy said he'd wanted to wait at least 2 rounds before he made any kind of predictions. I felt that was exactly where I was. And so after the after 2 rounds, if I had to put my money down then, I would have made the boring bet. I would have back to Fabiano. And I still feel that he's probably a very slight favorite. He doesn't have so much ground to make up. And I'm sort of assuming that Jan will have to overcome one more wobbly moment somewhere along the line. But not necessarily true, of course. If we've already seen Jan's wobble against Nakamura a couple of days ago, then he's probably the favorite.
Yeah, certainly shaping up to be a two-horse race. Again, the statistics don't lie. We can hope for, you know, a lot of drama with a huge cluster, but it's not statistically likely at this point. And yeah, Nepo dodged a bullet against Nakamura yesterday. Definitely one of the major what ifs. We've had a disproportionate number of draws so far.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, the field is very odd this year because it's very young, a lot of newcomers. And so there are a lot of unknowns. Like, you could see anything happening with Ali Reza, for example. And the fact that he disappeared for a few months before the event, then, you know, that sort of gives fire to the narrative that he's sitting back perfecting his classical chess. He didn't see him visibly online even for a while, although presumably he still was, I would imagine, to, you know, getting his hours in practicing there as well. But I could have seen him coming back and, you know, having solved the equation and roaring out to a lead. And I could have seen him succumbing to the lack of high pressure top stratosphere events that this is. I mean, this event is a real killer. I mean, I wonder if you could even argue that it can be harder to win the candidates in the world championship. Of course, it depends who the world champion is. But it strikes me that maybe that Magnus's most traumatic event was actually winning the candidates rather than any of his title matches.
Yeah.
And almost physically collapsed after it. And it was just insanely dramatic.
Yeah. And he very easily could have not won it and, greatly altered the course of chess history. I mean, he sort of tried not to win it.
Nervous is absolutely unbelievable. But there's so many cool stories to watch. I mean, Rapport is really impressed me with how incredibly original and risky, dynamic his play almost always is. Particularly the last two games with Black, I think, have been just tremendous to watch, even though they've both been draws and he nearly had an accident today. But just the chaos he creates. And I had a little chat with Anish today on Twitter at one point talking about how great it was to watch Rapport creating this amazing dynamic confusion in every game so early. And Anish was saying, he's playing the computer's best moves. This was very early in the opening. He had been talking about a specific move. But he's a joy to watch. I have a feeling I think it's a wonderful thing to see in the computer age that somebody can do that regularly. But I have a feeling the strain is immense.
You mentioned Ali Reza. I mean, aside from the winners, I feel like that's the biggest emerging storyline is the pressure potentially getting to him. I mean, when Nepo beat him in round four, you saw this moment where, you know, as he shook his hand, he just looked totally crushed. And then, you know, you wonder, a young guy like that, is he going to be able to recover? Consolidated yesterday, but today against Fabiano, I mean, to lose with white.
I thought
today
was very odd.
When
I said something about, I was wondering if there has been a lot of discussion about his openings, because his openings have been very odd for a guy who's spent months presumably doing nothing but preparing for this event. He had this sort of very odd accident against Nepo, where he played an ultra sharp line and almost immediately went wrong.
Yeah.
And then got mated. And then today, I don't know what he was doing, but it was both odd and easily diffused by making the most obvious natural moves on the board, I thought.
And 100 minutes on his first 19 moves today after hitting the one.
There was so much going on, I didn't even notice that. But there's something odd going on there. That's why I was trying to find out whose seconds were, because I thought his opening decisions have been puzzling.
Yeah, and the Nepo game, like as you mentioned, like he's the one springing the surprise, and he was somehow appeared to be out of book two moves later.
It's not exactly the kind of position where
even Firouzja doesn't want to be out of book in a night or on move 17 against Nepo with the black pieces. That's not a recipe for success. So
yeah,
that's been a big surprise.
Yeah, and exposing his king is part of the new idea, I suppose. I mean, that's another odd. I mean, if you look at the games Nepo's won, let's he just mates people. Absolutely. Yeah. And you'd think that, I don't know. I mean, obviously, there's not much you can do if the guy's in good form and that's what he's best at. But it seems like a lot of people are leading with their face against him.
I like that. Yeah.
It's a surprising number, actually. But okay. Yeah. I mean, this isn't a big surprise. I mean, one thing that strikes me is when people look back at this event afterwards, you'll get the great hindsight discussion, where I mean, you know, people may come out and say that round two was the pivotal one in the event, because Fabi was, I said, yeah, he was a bit better with black. I mean, messily better. I don't know how much, because I mean, I don't even, it seems to me that even the engines are changing their minds all the time nowadays. But it was quite clear that he was a bit better with black, and they'd both started fast. And obviously you want to kind of derail or shake up Jan as soon as possible.
Yeah.
A win with black against Nepo in the second round would have been, you know, atomic. But I mean, Fabiano's he's a very sensible, experienced guy, and I'm sure, you know, he wasn't winning. He was just messy winning, and actually very Nepo kind of messy position.
Yeah, and Fabi was shorter on time.
Yeah, but... I mean, so he's got to make a decision, you know. I don't think anybody in his experience would think, oh yeah, round two, let's go all in now.
Well, Magnus criticized him. I don't know if you caught that. Magnus, of course, joined the Chess24 broadcast yesterday and was letting it fly. He was not mincing words in terms of his judgment of the players. He said he didn't feel like anyone had played that impressively, and he was critical of Caruana's decision
in round two.
To not play on in that position, which is funny because, of course, Magnus is famed in, I mean, different circumstances, but preceding the tie breaks against Caruana, did not push his edge and came under a lot of criticism in a different situation. Yeah. But
that's the thing. I mean, it's very much a hindsight thing. I mean, what people, it seems to me, like viewers, spectators, and I know I'm not talking just about chess, I mean, but most sports, people never really factor into the equation that people have to make gigantic decisions with no time, you know, and then live with them. And this is something Magnus is extremely good at understanding and doing and being able to live with it, just like that decision and the match before, of course, when he sprung the novelty of not playing the last game in order to make gains.
That's right. So, yeah.
So he had, you know, he figured 48 hours of rest better than risking the match over the board in one game. And I mean, it was such a shocking decision when he did it. Nobody could understand what he was up to. But yeah, if it backfired, he'd look like an idiot. But that's the thing. You don't know until afterwards, and sportsmen have to make these decisions. And the only thing they can do is make them and live with them. And, you know, hindsight's just hindsight.
Right. Just and as you said,
I think in terms of odds, you don't go crazy in round two.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
And as you say, Fabi's in decent shape. I mean, obviously, like if Nepo's just had an otherworldly result, but he would have signed up for his current score, he would have signed up for 4 out of 6 before the tournament at this stage.
Sure.
I mean, often that's going to be in the lead, and he'll get another crack at Nepo. And then
I'm sure he thinks the return game he's going to be white. I mean, I just think that these guys are, sorry, the word, only the Norwegian word's coming to me right at the moment. their default setting is that's always a better opportunity than like a messy advantage with black. Just playing with white is that's the time to push.
Yeah, as you say, especially messy against Nepo. Well, Jonathan, we've got a bunch of good questions for you from Twitter, but first we're going to take a break and hear from our sponsors. Listeners, just a very quick reminder from our friends at Chessable. You should be watching GM Anish Giri's daily recap videos of the candidates. What a treat to get that from an elite player. For Chessable Pro members, there's also a course that goes along with it that you can get for free if you are a Chessable Pro member. So be sure to check that out, as well as the litany of excellent products from Chessable.com. And we are back. And I took to Twitter to see, I know you're a popular guy there, Jonathan, and I and a lot of others were a little disappointed that you didn't, that we're not getting to read your writing this time around. Hopefully that will be rectified for the next World Championship. We always enjoy your coverage. And we had two similar questions. One was from at Fantasy Chess on Twitter asking, is the candidates already over? Are we more likely to see a World Championship match between Nepo and Fabi than we are between either of these two and Magnus? And he's alluding, of course, to the fact that Magnus has said he's unlikely to defend his title against the older generation. Well, guess what? If it's like a 90% chance that one of his two previous challengers are the winner, then he's probably not going to defend his title. So if we hold him to his word, I know some people don't believe him, but if we do, then I understand where this question is coming from. Do you have any insights on this premature speculation, Jonathan?
Well, I think in terms of, I think the gist of the answer, I suppose, is Magnus, really, because it's very hard to imagine either Nepo or Fabiano not winning the event now. I was going to say maybe second place is still a bit much up for grabs, but it's pretty clear. It's looking very much two horse race, and with a field with so many young and inexperienced candidates, it's unlikely to change very much. For a long time, I never really got a chance to talk to Magnus about these kind of things. But there was a period there where I got to interview him quite regularly. And unfortunately, the last time I talked to him, it was just before Dubai. And he'd made it fairly clear that he didn't make it fairly clear, but he hinted very strongly that it was going to be his last match. And he sort of said he'd tell me more about it after the event. And I haven't had a chance to interview him since. So unfortunately, I can't give you any inside update on that. I think people who don't take him seriously probably don't remember the title timeline with Magnus. I mean, when he was young and could have been the youngest world champion, of course, he actually dropped out of the cycle.
Yeah,
because he didn't like the way it's set up. He's never liked the way it's set up. He's never liked the pressure and the unbelievable workload and tension, I think, that comes with it. But the thing is, you know, he has like the perfect killer champion mentality. But once he decided to get it, and once he had it, those people, they don't really like to give these things away. And I think this is what's been keeping him coming back, because he really doesn't like it. And he is very much, I think it's always been quite clear that throughout his career, he plays chess because he loves it. And when you start to bring in things that make it less fun, then he'll make some sharp decisions. Like he'll fire Kasparov as his trainer because the guy is just too intense. And, you know, he very rarely says things he doesn't mean. I mean, I would go so far as to say he never says things he doesn't mean. But so he hasn't said 100%. He hasn't. He won't play. But I think you have to take very seriously the chance that he won't play. And when I joke about trying to try and bring public opinion or start writing about things to make him reconsider. There are some interesting statistics. I mean, he's talking about, he would have been played five title matches and retire undefeated then, which sounds great. And it will have been 10 years. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you consider Kasparov had to play five matches just to get rid of Karpov. The first match alone was the equivalent of four modern title matches in terms of length. Yeah?
Yeah.
In terms of legacy, if you want to leave a lasting mark as a world champion and retire undefeated, okay, Kasparov, of course, was never going to retire undefeated, but still, Kasparov has played an unbelievable number of title games. Absolutely incredible. I mean, I don't even think you could really compare the amount of, you know, suffering. Those games lasted days as well when you go back to the first matches. But the thing is, you know, I would like to, you know, bring up those historical points and discuss them and say, you know, Magnus, please think about, you know, further cementing your position in history. But I don't think he cares.
Yeah.
Basically, I think, you know, if he doesn't want to, he won't do it. And it's very hard to see him not being the number one rated player in the world for a very long time to come. And I think that's what he feels is the most important and most convincing. So.
Yeah, and I do feel like Fabiano versus Nepomniachtchi would be a fascinating match, but it wouldn't feel like a world championship, though.
Yeah, exactly. I think it would be a great match, but yeah. I don't know. People forget pretty quickly. That's a danger for Magnus as well. Yeah. Although I'm sure he'll be hanging around trying to be 2,900, and that'll attract enough attention.
Yeah,
but I hope he plays. I have a feeling he'd much rather play Fabiano, because whenever you ask him about this, and he's still always says the same thing. He's really most interested in playing Fabiano. He considers Fabiano and Ding the only really dangerous opponents, and Alireza, of course, is the most interesting one because he's, I suppose, the future.
Yeah.
So.
And I saw you retweeted Anish Giri, Nepo playing Fabi for the world championship title, and let's call it a day.
I saw somebody asking about which of the rematches would be more interesting or likely, or I don't know, interesting maybe, or maybe likely to keep Magnus in the game. I kind of hope he'd be motivated to fully motivated to play Fabiano again, because I know how highly rates him, and it's not exactly like he's proved that much.
Yeah.
In their first match. So I think that would be fascinating to see. Although I don't feel that Fabiano's recaptured the heights he had then. It's far too early for to say that that was the peak of his career, of course, but that was maybe the best form he's had over a prolonged period just before the Magnus match. But that would be cool. I'd love to see that. Maybe that might interest Magnus enough. The big question is a rematch against Nepo, of course.
Yeah. And we haven't talked about Nakamura at all. What have you thought of Hikaru's play?
I think it's great. He's great. He's absolutely fantastic. I mean, it's tremendous, because I've always been fascinated by people who can really play without any pressure. And of course, there's been this practically a meme about, you know, Hikaru doesn't care all the way through the qualification for the candidates and his comeback and him getting a wild card spot when he was supposed to be retired on all this. But I mean, it's a slightly but important difference between him not caring and not trying. I mean, I think whenever he plays, he's going to try to win. Of course, he's going to work hard no matter what kind of an event it is. And the not caring thing is just that he's just not putting pressure on himself the way he used to. I mean, he's been number two in the world and talking about being the only one to defeat Sauron and all of these things. And it puts a lot of pressure on yourself, especially when you're not scoring against Magnus. He had a terrible, terrible score against Magnus. But you know, he has eventually become quite solid against Magnus, and you can see him. The first year of the Magnus tour was an unbelievably exciting and dramatic series of duels between the two of them. Okay, it's not classical, but still, it's hard to believe he'd have a chance in a match against Magnus. But it would be a tremendously popular spectacle, I think, in terms of the public. Arguably the two biggest promoters of the game. And I don't know, he'd probably do better now than he would have done before, because He doesn't have that pressure at all, really at all. And I think it's great. It's great to see him reporting every day.
Those recaps are fun. Yeah. And then, of course, he had the key game yesterday against Nepo. That was really a sliding doors moment. If he could have won that game, and you know, his disappointment was palpable. It wasn't.
That would have been huge. Yeah.
But now a point and a half back. It seems like, I mean, again, Ty's model, any statistical rating model is going to put Naka below 5%. But I feel like he does. Yeah, I mean, he does have an better chance than that of sliding into second, which if it looks like Magnus is going to vacate the throne, Naka even sliding in to play Nepo or Caruana, that would be pretty exciting.
You just look at the way he qualified for this thing. I mean, he won how many games in a row at the Grand Prix when he had to qualify in his second event? I mean, it's just he's capable of amazing things.
I mean, holding that position against Firouzja, that was like magic. Mm. I mean, that was incredible how fast he was playing at the end.
He's so good at that kind of thing. He's amazingly hard to beat. And actually converting against Radjabov was also extremely impressive. That was just, I mean, at first sight it might have looked like it should be just a technical win, but it was nightmarishly difficult, and he converted it quite smoothly. Now I think the big thing is, will Jan's wheels come off? That's the big question.
Shout out to Jakob Augard. He's been more vocal on Twitter lately, and he's always saying Jan's a momentum guy. You know, he's still not buying the Jan hype train.
Well, I mean, he's already had his wobble. I mean, and not by wobble, I just don't mean he's getting into trouble. Everybody's going to get into trouble at some point in the event. But the way he got into trouble against Naka was just unbelievable. I mean, he made two sort of
self-inflicted wounds.
I used a total of maybe, 30 seconds on them? I mean, like the time needed. He's practically had his hand out before Naka was finished moving. It was just, it's that kind of thing. Suddenly his hand takes over for it. And it's great. When you're in good form, that happens with even more effect. But you do it all the time, it's going to catch up with you. I mean, Vichy was talking about this.
Well, Magnus too.
But Vichy used to be unreal.
Oh, right. Yeah, similar, predisposition.
And he said, you know, sooner or later, you make enough bad, quick decisions that you realize you can't do that as your default setting.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if people know how fast Vichy was, because, I mean, that was quite a while ago. But I mean, I can remember turning up watching teenage Vichy playing in London and watching some guy in horrific time pressure quite early in the first session and wandering over and seeing that the guy was playing Vichy. But not only that, they were in the second session. That's how fast Vichy was.
Yeah. And just crushing people. Amazing. But Magnus had a few choice words about Nepo, that position where he could have gone queen d7 or queen e4, and he just puts his queen in the line of fire. Magnus is pretty ruthless in his criticism of Nepo's pragmatism or lack thereof there. All right, John, we got to take one more break, and then we, as I mentioned, lots of good Twitter questions to dive into. Perpetual Chess is brought to you in part by aimchess.com. My latest discovery on aimchess.com is, in addition to its algorithm generating statistics and telling you trends from your opening games, there's a tab at the top where you can go to game history and review individual games, and it tags recurring issues. So for example, it keeps telling me I had good openings, but it also tells me when I was behind on the clock, when I failed to convert an advantage. So you can then, within the Aim Chess platform, review the game and look for leaks that you need to plug, things to correct. So one of the many ways you can use aimchess.com to improve your game. So you can check it out for free. And if you choose to subscribe, use the code perpetual30 to save 30%, or you can also use the link on aimchess.com that is provided in the show description. And we are back. And before we start haranguing you about your follow-up book, Jonathan, we got some more candidates to talk to to get into. Number one, shout out Grandmaster Dennis Boros on Twitter, who was asking how this compares to the candidates of the old days. Obviously, you've been writing about them for decades. So is there anything you particularly miss?
Well, it probably ties in a lot with the other Twitter arguments I've been getting into about increments and non-increments. I think it's wonderful to see the return of non-increment until final.
I feel like session. Most people are agreeing with you. Magnus, Jan Gustafsson, Agard, all have said, no kid gloves.
I understand both sides of the argument very, very well. I mean, I sympathize with both sides of the argument, but
actually, Jonathan, sorry, we should lay out what it is for anyone wondering. So basically, obviously, with the advent of the digital clock in the past couple of decades, previously there was no way to add time on each given move. And at some point, the conventional time control became to add time after every single move. So instead of like 40 moves in 2.5 hours, which were the first time control back in the Kasparov days, it might be 40 moves in 2 hours with a 30-second increment or something along those lines. And in this tournament, they do not have increments for the first two time controls. The idea being people can manage their own time, and it adds an opportunity for more drama and more mistakes if you're not forced to have, as Agard tweeted, this sort of handcuff. So anyway, that's the context of what people are talking about when they debate the increment. And sorry, you can finish what you were saying, Jonathan.
Yeah, well, I mean, the thing is, of course, in the old 40 and 2.5 days, you would adjourn and the game would be, you would analyze the game either yourself or with your seconds or such. The rise of engines has meant we've got to get the game finished in one session. And then gradually, as engines have had more of a impact in the way people prepare and things, people have tried to make, to raise the human factor by speeding the game up. Whereas you can see very quickly that when they play without, there's never any sort of horrible pieces getting knocked over, screaming hysterics, because you have absolutely no time to make your last 10 moves as you did in the old days. You always now have this 30 seconds per move. But the problem is that people have adapted to the point where 30 seconds is quite a lot of time for them now. And so it has perhaps civilized the physical aspect of a time scramble, but it's also made it much harder for people to blunder. And of course, blunders aren't necessarily what we're aiming for, but... It's sort of an integral part. But also, I mean, if you give the person their whole 2 hours to begin with, whereas now quite often it's 90 minutes and 30 seconds increment over 20, so that's an extra 20, so it's 100. So it's slightly less time now. You give them 40 in 2 hours, they have more time and they get to use it as they will. And it actually makes a big difference. If your huge complex decisions come relatively early in the game, you're actually, you have this problem. How much of my time do I invest now? Because the most important decisions are now. So you can actually make more informed, better, higher quality decisions if you ration your time properly. If you get it wrong, of course, then you have terrifying race to the end. But it's not the biggest skill, I think, for people to adapt to, managing their own time, allowing how much time you're going to think at critical moments, how much, if I'm going to burn it early, am I going to try and use it as a weapon? Most people nowadays try to use the clock as a weapon, try and gain an edge, and then make people make mistakes because they come under more bigger time pressure than they are. To my mind, every time the game speeded up, in the old days, people were thinking, oh my God, this is just going to lead to chaos because people can't think properly. And of course, the game is much, much faster now and people are still producing good games. So I think in terms of time management, I mean, to me, the biggest danger of non-increment time controls like this is not that you might risk huge blunders, but which I think is, that means you're not mastering one of your core skills. I think the big danger is that they will completely adapt to this so quickly that we'll be back where we were. But it's just, it gives us a few more interesting aspects to,
yeah. I mean, to my mind, the games have been fascinating so far, but there has been a high level, a high percentage of draws. I think some of that is just luck. There have been a lot of sort of two-sided struggles that have ended in draws. Yeah. But anyway, I mean, anything that sort of encourages decisive results in an event like this and it retains the veneer of classical chess, I am in favor of.
Well, yeah, that's the thing is, I mean, in terms of... We've been in a cycle of... Or not even a cycle. We've been in increasing speed, less time to think arc as a solution to this. And if you take out the increment, you're actually giving them more time to produce quality chess. But if they don't use that time wisely, then we get real fun in games when they're trying to make the time control. I think it's, for a while at least, it has the possibility of being the best of both worlds and bringing back a great aspect of the old classical chess days to modern chess. And then if you start getting scandals where people are so nervous they're knocking everything over, maybe you can add a, you know, like they do with in other events, you just can give them 2 seconds for a non-knocking the piece over increment kind of thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah, something
you
like
know, some
that.
Sort of compromise solution where you get, you know,
yeah, the bare minimum.
Yeah, a protection against total chaos, but not detract from the actual real-time pressure. I think that might be something is you know to consider. But I like it, and I'm glad to hear that Magnus likes it. I know he found it slightly uncomfortable, but I think you know he appreciates it.
Well, I mean, it produced Game 6 of the World Championship, one of the most heightened drama moments in recent history.
Yeah, but that's what I was having a chat with somebody on Twitter about this. I mean, look, I was wondering if people who find it slightly disturbing that a game can be lost because of time pressure. I mean, they can still do it. For me, I don't understand how people can play on 30-second increments all the time. But I've watched a lot of world championship matches, like almost all of the Kasparov-Karpov games. And this kind of thing would happen all the time. It was a part of the dramatic development of almost every game, that you would get this incredibly dramatic crescendo in the final half hour or something. And it's been such a long time since we've seen that. I couldn't remember as exciting a series of time controls as in Game 6 since maybe the end of one of the very early Karjakin Carlsen games where Magnus was pressing for a win with very little material and insanely little time for both of them.
Yeah. All right. Well, Jonathan, since this will, a lot of people won't have too many days to listen to this while it's still timely, let's get to a few more questions and then we should probably wrap things up and have a longer conversation in the future. So this question is from a friend of the podcast, Christopher Chabri, who asks, why does Nepo seem to do so well against 2750 opponents, but so poorly against 2850 opponents? He says, half joke, half serious question.
Well, I think it's just the strain of playing Magnus, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, down in this, I guess, sort of heroic flaw he has, with an ability to suppress his impulsiveness or his confidence at certain points in the games. And of course, I mean, I know Chris is kind of joking, more than maybe half joking, but I mean, it's not necessarily, I mean, it could well happen here. It doesn't have to be Magnus. I think it's just a fascinating aspect of his character and his personality. And it's just like with your the wisdom of hindsight, should he have played against Magnus like Tal would have played against Magnus? Yeah. Just be true to himself, play fast, play sharp, play, you know.
Yeah.
This is considered madness now at the title level. And when you get to the title match, then you have to, you've got to have your technique down, your defense. You don't lose with black. That's top of the list. Okay, and then Magnus, he just wears everybody down. Maybe you should just say, I'm going to be who I am. And I mean, it's easy to say it because he didn't do it and it didn't work. But up until like halfway through game six, we didn't know at all what was going on. I mean, Magnus could easily have been behind in the match both before that and during that game or after that game. So it's very hard to say. It would be cool to see him try and just play.
Yeah, I mean, if we were going to get a rematch, which I agree with you, as you said earlier, it's the least likely rematch. If Nepo wins, it does seem like Magnus would not be particularly interested in defending. But that would be a fun way for him to approach it, is just like vintage Nepo instead of play the Petrov and the Queen's Gambit decline. Yeah, Nepo.
I'm sure that's what that's what we all want to see. And I wonder if deep down that's what he wants to do.
Yeah. Okay, another question from Brian Karen of the Chessbook Collectors Facebook group. Brian asks, does GM Tisdall agree that the high levels of computer preparation that map games to, quote, safe positions have made the match format for world championships outdated? Is there anything he would suggest be done, or does he not consider it a problem? So kind of related to what we were just discussing.
Well, it's certainly a problem. I don't think anybody denies it's a problem. I think Magnus thinks it's a huge problem, obviously, and he's very close to being 100% we should be doing some other format.
Yeah.
I still have, I wouldn't panic just yet. I mean, we still, you know, I don't see any reason why we should scrap the classical discipline. I mean, engines are getting so strong that we're almost not being able to understand what they're talking about now. I'm kind of looking forward to when they're so strong that their assessments mean nothing to us, absolutely nothing to us. But of course, that won't stop people from being able to use them and prepare and all that. But then if you look at rapport, and as I was, you know, Anish was joking with me today slightly that, you know, he's playing the best computer moves. Right. Rapport, almost every round seems capable of steering the game into places nobody has been before. So I think there's still some hope that we'll get guys with the right temperament and perhaps, you know, eventually even more cyborg types who manage to humanize the computer wisdom in some way that we can get classical matches being played at levels of bafflement that sort of bring back the decisive games and the level of drama that we saw before. So I wouldn't give up yet.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, we will see. Everything's unfolding so quickly with how much stronger these computers are getting. But we will see. So we had one more Twitter question that I definitely want to get to. And this one is from Finally in FM, who says, ask you about your, quote, beyond normal experiences that you said are better suitable for pub talk, but he said the podcast is not far away, right? And I believe he was referring to you on June 15th, you tweeted, I guess I won't be writing about the candidates. Might be a good thing, as the few strong opinions I have aren't really printable. So as he said, this is not print. No. So.
Well, I can tell you what he's talking about. I had a tweet that nobody responded to asking if anybody had any sort of telepathic experiences while playing chess. It was something like that. And I don't remember why I brought it up.
That's what it
must have been. It must have been some game or some incident where, it was about double blindness. It was in relation to double blindness. And I can't remember what. Oh, it was when Anand resigned against Mamyadarov at Norway Chess, and Mamyadarov came back and asked him why he resigned. So you have a situation where Anand has just made a horrific blunder, losing everything he owns, basically. And once he notices, he gives up. Mamyadarov was actually expecting the move that Anand had played and didn't see anything wrong with it.
Right.
And even stranger, the fact that Mamyadarov was a tremendous tactician, didn't notice and was expecting the blunder is one thing. But also, as several people pointed out afterwards, Mamyadarov was actually threatening to make the winning move before, and neither of them noticed that either. So you have this weird situation in cases of double blindness where it's very hard to understand why something that's incredibly obvious suddenly doesn't appear on their radar at all. Yeah. And even when one guy sees it, the hypnotic effect of whatever was going on there, that still doesn't wear off for one of them. And it's a really weird state of affairs. And in chess history, you've had some great double blindness moments. I mean, of course, Anand and Magnus had one in their world in their second match, which was, well, it was quite subtle. I mean, it wasn't like this thing against Mamedov.
Yeah, which was
I was curious about this whole thing about blindness, and obviously something odd is going on when two players of that level don't notice something that obvious, and seem like, and one of them is completely oblivious to it,
And but so it wasn't like hanging a piece, you know. I mean, it's one of those moves where if you look at it, you like, for listeners who didn't see the position, it was probably like a 2000 level tactic, but it was one of those things where if you look at the move at their level, you'll instantly see it works, but you are giving up your queen. So it is possible to have the blindness where you just don't look at the queen sacrifice. So to me, it was more understandable than some blunder where you just hang a piece or something, you know, like Fabi recently put a piece where it could be captured in a tournament game. Like, that's a whole nother level. But yeah, the fact that it was double blindness does add some intrigue.
Yeah, but it wasn't like very deep either. It was like a one.
Yeah, two moves or something. Yeah.
So yeah. And of course, over time, you know, if you go back over history, you'll see people like two top players missing mate, this, you know, missing mate and this kind of thing. Just like oblivious to this. And there is some sort of interesting thing going on mentally here where the expectation that something like that is going to happen against a person of that level is so strong that I'm not going to make a mistake like this. He's not going to make a mistake. They just don't see it, kind of thing. And so there's a lot of discussion. Should Vichy have resigned, or should he have just sat there and,
you know? I mean, he definitely shouldn't have resigned with the benefit of hindsight. I mean, the fact that it took a minute or two like that already should be a clue that you shouldn't resign, but he just couldn't take the tension.
I was asked, I made this tweet about if anybody had noticed, had some sort of an experience like, and I think I might have used the word telepathic, but something where some mental anomaly had occurred. And I suppose I phrased it in such an X-Files kind of way that nobody wanted to take it seriously or enter into the discussion. And I think that's what his question is referring to. And I could go into a couple of, I just had some very odd experiences, not very often, once or twice I remember having a postmortem with John van der Veel where the absolute it was like our minds were melded during like 60-70% of the game, where we started to analyze and we started to demonstrate variations, and and it didn't matter how weird the variation was, we both looked at precisely the same things, all the same the same branches, the same, and it was obvious to us very quickly something odd was going on, because it started, you know, the first few variations, and then we started to check, and we just kept doing it, and, you know, trying to verify if the other person had seen these odd, you know, the oddest of our thoughts, and we were just in complete sync until I made a blunder eventually. But it was a very, very odd experience. But the thing that really stuck with me is that at one point, there was a key point when I was playing in the Hastings Challengers. And I was doing very well, but I mean, it's one of these tournaments where there's only one prize. You have to come first in order to qualify for the Grandmaster tournament. And I'd managed to have the off day, the really off day. I was playing some guy who was that I really was supposed to beat. And my position was a ruin, an absolute ruin. And I can remember very consciously at one point sitting in this position and thinking, does he have a move that loses? And then finding one, and then thinking, I'm going to think this move at him. And I sat there concentrating as hard as I could, thinking this move, ridiculous move at him. And he played it. And afterwards, he couldn't explain it.
Do you give lessons?
obviously, if this is, if there's anything, besides wild coincidence to this, you should obviously be trying to work on this skill. But I would assume that it's only, if it is woo-woo, that it's only going to occur when you're young enough to have that kind of energy and under that kind of extreme desire and stress. But it was weird. It was really weird. And these kind of things, I don't know. You know, you're both looking at each other really hard. I have no idea. But it's just, those are the two things that in that vein that's left an impression on me anyway as being.
Okay, well, fascinating stuff and good fodder for a longer interview someday. But I've got two more things before we wrap up, Jonathan. Number one, I got to follow up. So your tweet, the few strong opinions I have aren't really printable. Are there any you can share here? This was in regard to the upcoming candidates at the time on before.
Yeah, no, but I really, I said that was quite a serious tweet. This is just this. I would just say there might be somebody that I don't really feel comfortable writing about in the end. That's all. And I really don't want to say more than that.
Okay. We'll leave that there. And then last but not least, we had two people. I'm always wondering when your new book, I know you've mentioned in other interviews, you're working on another book and Christopher Sabri weighed in and someone else. We all want to know when is the sequel to the classic book, Improve Your Chess Now, going to see the light of day, if ever.
Yeah. Now, like it's now been over a decade of excuses and explanations. Just the few things I always like to say is that it's not a sequel, it's a prequel. I, as many people have observed, and I have always agreed, I find the title of the book slightly, it's catchy and it's commercial, but it doesn't reflect on the difficulty level of the book. And I've always sort of regretted that it feels like it should be more accessible than it is. It's a very difficult book. So I wanted to do sort of a prequel where I do a combination of two things, sort of revisit the key points in that and try to make them provide material so that they're a bit more accessible, they're explained in greater depth, more examples, this and that. I'm writing it with a co-author. This further complicates matters because we're both really good at
procrastination
and getting over-involved and trying to tweak things and giving each other ideas so that we don't settle. I mean, the first book took ages, and the first book only went to print because Murray Chandler, who was my editor at the time, said, okay, I'm putting it in the catalog. You have... X weeks to actually deliver it. And so, it was more or less, it was actually written, but I just sit there tweaking. So right. Hopefully it will come soon. We've had COVID, okay, of course, in the way now to make it further delayed and house moving and this and that. I have some very strong opinions about how to finish it. A lot of it is written and a vast amount of it, enough for two or three books of material actually exists. And I think the most encouraging sign for actual completion is that I've had a chance to road test a lot more of the material now. It means that the stuff I thought was finished might have to be rewritten, but I've, thanks to COVID, if you could say that, I had a couple of years of remote teaching of various levels and countries. And so I've had a chance to get a much wider feel for what works and what needs to be tweaked a bit. Hopefully soon.
Okay, well, we all need something to look forward to in life. So we'll keep our fingers crossed. Are you able to reveal who the co-author is, or is that still under wraps?
I can tell you who the co-author is, and you should definitely look him up. His name's Nick Duty. He's a stand-up comedian.
Ah, right.
So hopefully he'll be lend an engaging aspect to the book. he's a very talented amateur. In fact, I mean, that's one of the other problems is that when I was just thinking this book must be brought down to make it more accessible than the first one was. And I thought having an actual live student voice, and Nick, he's incredibly well-read and incredibly enthusiastic. And he responded fantastically well when he actually started this. I mean, I think his rating went up 400 points or something.
Wow.
When he started. But the problem is that he is quite a strong player. And so again, I had to progressively sort of ramp up stuff as we were going through it. So we've gone away from the slightly, you know, wider audience. Well, no, we haven't gone completely away, obviously, because I have a student voice and I have tested it on a wide range of students now. But slight complication that he's stronger than perhaps he should have been. But he's great, great comedian. I strongly urge you to find his stuff online.
Okay, we'll check that out. Yeah, and hopefully look forward to the book. And late breaking question from Twitter, which I normally would ignore, but I realize we haven't mentioned much about Ding. So Tom Ulig just chimed in and said, why is my boy Ding not winning the candidates? We should probably address that before we say our goodbyes.
Yeah, it's a really good question. Yeah, I mean, because you could say that he has been even less active than a lot of other people, but I don't know. Nobody's been terribly active during the COVID years. I slightly wonder if he's developing the kind of, I don't want to hurt anybody, but a sort of an Aronian type of complex where the occasion might get to them a bit.
Mm-hmm.
It really is odd because he's such a strong player.
Yeah, but and he's clearly
Ronian, of course. I mean, they're the kind of guys you think that they don't need much to go right to actually win the thing. But it hasn't clicked yet.
Yeah, and he's just not approaching his normal level. I mean, you know, I'm just a lowly 2100, but I can see the lack of crispness and like whole sequences of moves. Mm. I know he came under some criticism, you know, for like he only arrived a couple of days before, you know, like
yes,
suddenly the Chinese team isn't appearing in the Olympiad. It just seems that there's this sort of like lack of appreciation of the moment, which, you know, we would have been laughable to suggest if he'd been firing on all cylinders, as, you know, could have happened. But now that he isn't, these questions will be raised.
The lack of support from his federation?
Yeah, I mean, it seems to be a combination of factors. But yeah, no, as Jan Gustafsson has been talking about on the Chess 24 broadcast, everyone is there with a team except for him. Like, it's a long tournament, you know, to be there on your own. That to me seems more challenging, even for an introvert, you know, like
he does seem to be handicapped in some way. That's true. And I think that's fair to say, you know, without wanting to make excuses for him. It's quite possible that his road to qualification was quite disturbing as well. Suddenly finding out that, you know, you've been the world number 2.5 for so long and you're not going to be able to get in at all because of a variety of circumstances, and then having to play like a zillion games in a row in China to get your activity. And I don't know, there's nothing has been ideal about his preparation for the event. I mean,
yeah. And I will give a parting shout out to Christoph Selecki, Chess Explained. He was vocal on Twitter before the tournament that he didn't think circumstances were right for Ding, and he was not predicting a strong performance. I'll take the L. I thought Ding was rightfully the favorite. It's I'm basically prepared to write him off, unfortunately. It just doesn't seem like it's in the cards.
It's interesting. I'm curious to know what kind of intel he had on that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I'm hopefully I'll get a chance to ask him soon. So So listeners, we're going to say our goodbyes to Jonathan. A couple programming notes. We're still releasing the regular interviews on Tuesdays. We'll have another candidates bonus pod next Friday after round 12, or next Thursday night / Friday after round 12. And then we'll take things for there. So hope you all are enjoying the games. Obviously things could still change, but yeah, it's primarily a two-horse race at this point. Pending revision if someone stumbles or someone ascends. But Jonathan, it's been a pleasure to get your insights. As we said, long overdue, but I really appreciate it. Everyone, those of you listening, even those of you who aren't regularly on Twitter, as I've said before, during big chess events, especially like the candidates in the World Championship, you know, it can be fun to pop in and follow the Jonathan Tisdalls and Tarje Svensons and Olympia Urcans and Douglas Griffins and just keep up with a few people, and it makes the experience more enjoyable. So thank you, Jonathan.
No, thanks. It was good to finally make it, as I say.
Yes, definitely. And we'll look forward to more drama and more history to be written. Thanks to everyone who helps make Perpetual Chess possible. Big shout out to my producer, Matthew Passy. I'd also like to thank the Blue Wire Podcast Network, with whom we are proud to be affiliated. Be sure to follow us on social media, Beneficial1 on Twitter, at Perpetual Chess on Instagram, and or you can join the Perpetual Chess Facebook group. You can email me, ben@perpetualchesspod.com. And of course, last but not least, I'd like to give major thanks to the Perpetual Chess Patreon and PayPal supporters. Those who choose to join that community based on their level of support can do things like submit questions for guests of the show, have access to live Zoom Q&A lectures with grandmasters who often have appeared on the show, going over chess games, answering questions, stuff like that. And you can even get access to ad-free Perpetual Chess if that's your preference. So, but most of all, thanks to everyone for listening, and we will catch you all on the next episode.